Now I would like to invite Dr. Deepak Kumar Panda. He is working as a senior technical lead in Mercedes Benz Research and Development India Private Limited, Bangalore, Karnataka. He is working for a trial pilot. His work includes development and testing of localization algorithms, perception-based positioning using HD map and sensors, detecting landmarks using sensor fusion, handling projects with a cross-functional global teams. He has a number of scientific publications and patents on his name. He is also leading a team in land detection for extreme weather conditions, where the team is developing algorithms using deep learning. Prior to joining MBRDI, he completed his PhD and MTech from National Institute of Technology, Rourkela, Odisha, awarded with best research in his department. Dr. Deepak Kumar Panda. You have to unmute your mic. I think your mic is muted.
Yeah, thank you, Sneha. So is my screen visible to you?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thanks for the information. Okay, so Sneha has told everything about what we do. So I'm from Mercedes-Benz, and I work for a team which do localization for self-driving cars. So our team is responsible for level 2 and level 3 self-driving cars localization. And when I say localization, I mean to say that we should be able to tell exactly where exactly the car is in world coordinate system. Okay, so for that, we take input from sensor, we take input from map. And when we talk about sensor, there are lots of sensor, and there are lots of data. Okay, and how we process these sensor data, map data, and how do we find out the erroneous situation, that I'll be covering in my last slide. For data analytics, what we do. So let's start with the presentation. And if you have any doubts, you can always ask me. So this is localization in self-driving cars. So before I start, I would like to tell you about what these levels are. So these levels are defined by Society of Automotive Engineers. And when I say this level 3, I mean it's a traffic jam chauffeur. Okay, so let me have my pointer. Okay, so when I say level 3, it's meant for traffic jam chauffeur. So it will be used only on highways. Okay, it won't be available for cities. And level 2, when I talk about level 2, so it will have some features of lane centering and adaptive cruise control at the same time. And when you hear about this level 4, it's all about highway taxis, okay, local driverless taxis, which will be available in cities where certain preconditions are met, and it can take you from it can take you from place A to place B. And in level 5, you do not have a driver. Okay, so there is a good definition. If you want to know about this level 3, you can take off your eyes, you can take off your brain, and you can take off the driver here. So this is what we do, and how do we localize the car? So as I said, localization means we should be able to localize the vehicle in world coordinate system. And for that, we have GPS. But GPS can be erroneous. Okay, so how do we do that? That I'll be speaking. And this is also, we are also part of this level 2. And recently, the S-Class, which was unveiled in the month of September last year, it had this level 2 feature. Okay, so let me show you one video which is talking about this level 3 concept. Okay, is the audio audible to you?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, just a minute. Okay, so I'm not getting the option to share my audio. Is it? Yeah, it's okay. What you can do is this video is available in YouTube. One can go and have a look at this link, which I'll provide you. You can go and have a look. So what exactly? Yes.
Yeah, you can put it on speaker if you remove the headphone and put it on speaker.
Okay, so let me.
Not
sir, what you can do is like choose the option, select like present only a tab and open YouTube in that particular tab, and then the audio will be audible via YouTube.
So have you disconnect the headphone from computer?
Sir, the mic is mute right now, sir.
Yeah, it's okay. So what I can say is this YouTube is not available currently.
I think Dr. Deepak, you can continue without audio, because you know concept is more important. Please go ahead.
Yes, I can tell more on when the video starts. Okay, so let's start with this. So this is level 3, and this level 3 will be available to new users, okay, and this is going to be next this year, most probably by the end of this year, or most probably by the next year, okay. So this is how the video looks like, and here we take input from different sensor, and we take input from different sensor, and we take input from GPS. So GPS tells you where exactly the car is, but that can be an erroneous position. So how do we tackle that? That is what is shown here. So for that, we take help of different sensor. It can be your SMPC, it can be your LiDAR, it can be so SMPC can see the traffic sign, it can see the lane markings, and this is available only when the landmarks are available and when the lane markings are available. And if it is not available, then it won't be available to you. So this is one precondition, and one of the precondition is that it's only available when it is on the highway, and for the starting purpose, it will be available only to the German. So it will be available in the German Autobahn, and if it sees a traffic signs, it's closed down automatically. This is what the concept is, and I'll be speaking more on this. So instead of going into this video, let's have a look at the video, and this is the complete demo. I'll drop a link of this YouTube video link. So this is the Immendingen Mercedes Proving Ground. So this is the proving ground, and this is publicly available. You can go and have a look. So this was the same press event which was being used for the launch of S-Class Level 2. And at that time, the press was invited to have a look at how the level three will look like, which I said, most probably by the end of this year or next year, we will be means we will be launching this feature most and specifically for Europeans, and then everything goes well, then it will be launched slowly to US and China. Okay, so when I told you about there are different sensors, so there are you have global navigation satellite system, okay, and then you have radars, you have multimode radars, you have SMPC, and you have LIDARs. Okay, so there are different sensors. You have long range radar, and you have long range radar, you have long range LIDAR, ultrasonics all around the car, and then you have SMPC. So you have different sensors, and different sensor they are good in detecting the objects, detecting the landmarks. They are good in detecting the lane markings. Okay, so I can just tell you a brief idea how do we localize the level three car. Okay, so this one is the GNSS. We get the position from the GNSS. Then the same position is used to take input from high definition map, and this high definition map is stored. It's come from HERE maps, okay? So it's come from HERE, but the data will be in NDS format. But that data needs to be converted to ADASIS stream, and all these processing is being done here. And I showed you the vehicle sensor. You have vehicle sensor, and then vehicle sensors. You have different sensor, and all these sensors are getting fused. And then we do a lateral localization. We first start with a lateral localization. I mean that first we have to localize where exactly the car is, in which lane the car is. Once we are able to localize, then we would like to localize the vehicle longitudinally in which road section. So this road section is nothing but a hypothetical chunk of roads which are 1 meter apart, and we have to tell exactly in which road section the car is. And for that, we take input of sensor and high definition map, and here landmarks are being used. Here, for lateral localization in which lane the car is, we take lane markings. It can be moving map and distance to border. And here in this case, we take only the landmarks which are available on the road, okay? And this is the position which we get, and this is the position which we get from your GPS. Finally, it is being fused, and it is being given to different ADAS applications, okay? So let me go, how do we do this lateral localization? So this one is, we use the concept of a Bayesian filter, okay? And then, so first thing is we start with a control update. Okay, the control update is basically, it will tell you there is SMPC and there is a LIDAR, which will tell you whether there is a specific lane change event has happened or not. Okay, so this is the control update UFT. And we start with the control update, and control update will tell you that whether there is a lane change event has happened or not. And once this is done, then we do a measurement update. So measurement update will tell you where exactly the lane is. So we start with the belief that the car was in this lane, and the probability to reach the lane x of t, it can be any lane in the next road section. So that probability is given by this, okay? And this is the measurement update. So this is the measurement update belief of the car at present, and this is the normalization factor. And then we come up with exactly in which road section the car is, okay? And then this is being used to localize laterally. So it can be used as, means we can use the line marking. So line marking can be compared with the map data, then distance to border. This can be used, distance to border and distance to free space, then moving map. Vehicles on other lanes can also be used here. Okay, so this is, so, and for that we use the concept of a Bayesian filter. And so let's see, how do we localize longitudinally in which road section the car is. And for that, we use different landmarks which are available on the road. It can be your pole-like object, it can be your reflector, it can be your perpendicular walls, it can be your guardrail, it can be your signboards, which are known as sign face. It can be your traffic signs, regulatory signs, and overhead bridges. Okay, so if you see, these are all harder to detect. Perpendicular, this electric poles or reflectors. These are small, means the width is very small. So these are very harder to detect. But the moment you go here, these are easier to detect. These are signboards which are meant for drivers to see. Even the sensors can also read. Sensor can see the traffic sign and the regulatory signs, the overhead bridges. It's visible. It's clearly visible. And if you go here, this is the frequency, how frequent they are. So this is less frequent and this is very frequent. Okay. So this one is about longitudinal positioning. So how do we, so where exactly in which road section the car is. So for that, we take the help of landmarks which are available on the road. Okay, so we start with a uniform belief. So then based on the landmarks, we have got some hype. So this is the hype which is there. Okay, and then we do a control update. The control update will basically shift by that much distance the car has traveled. Okay, and the same thing has been shifted here. The belief has been shifted here. And then again, we do a measurement update. The measurement update will tell you that you are near to, you are seeing the reflector. So this can be this reflector, or this can be this reflector, and this is what is evident here. It's showing a peak at these two places. Again, you shift the hypothesis, and then again, so this is what is the belief has been shifted, and then again you do a measurement update. And by this time, the car is very certain that the vehicle is at this position. This is how we do longitudinal localization. Okay, and then again, you have a control update where we shift the histogram, and again we do a measurement update, and by this time the vehicle is certain that the vehicle is at this location. So this is how we do lateral localization and longitudinal localization. Okay, and as you have seen that we have too many sensors, and we take input from map, we take input from different sensor. It can be your LiDAR, it can be your radar, it can be your SMPC. So every time you hit the road, there will be some measurements, and these measurements contains lots of chunks of data. Okay, and these chunks of data needs to be analyzed for further improvement. Okay, so you can find out if your map is erroneous or your sensor is erroneous. It can help us to identify the bugs. It can help us to identify the corner cases where exactly the algorithm is not working. And then it can also help us what is the resource time if a function has been deployed, has been there in this embedded platform, then what is the runtime of that that stuff. So we would like to know. Okay, and how it helps us. So it helps us to reduce the developer's effort. If you start downloading the measurements, which will be in GBs, and if you download, you have to download, and then you have to analyze them. So it's an developer's nightmare. So he has to go over thousands of signals. So instead of that, what if we can run a script which can tell us where are we wrong, means what exactly, means what are we doing wrong. So that is what is being done, and this helps to improve the level 2 and level 3, and along with that it helps to improve the bug and it helps to improve the algorithm further. This is how we do the data analytics. And you have vehicle data. So vehicle is being driven all around the world, and these are being uploaded into a cluster, and then these are being converted into Parquet files, and the Parquet files are being run overnight, and this can give you results in very less time, and these results are uploaded continuous, and this is how we improve. For example, you have sign faces on the road, so but we would like to know what is the average width. So for that, what we have to do is we have to just go over all the sign faces which are there, and then we have to just find out what is the average width, and that can tune the algorithm. So this is how we use it in our purpose. And for example, you can do a meta search with all these measurements. For example, you need a road section where you had 3-lane and then suddenly it went to 4-lane. Or if you want to see when there is a lane change, when the car does a lane change, how you can improve the algorithm further. So all these things can be taken if you do the data analytics. So data analytics is a core part in our day-to-day activities. So yeah, any questions?
I have one question, Deepak. The presentation is very nice. So how about this adversarial attacks which are happening nowadays, and it's in trend in the research community? So is this algorithm, you know, robust to these adversarial attacks, or are you
so this adversarial attack, you mean with the deep learning?
If we change some pixels in the signboard, then we have seen that the prediction of that signboard will become different. So for example, if that signboard is showing go straight, and if we change some pixels or make a small hologram onto that signboard, then it might be the case, you know, the algorithm will detect it as left sign instead of right sign. So it's a sort of adversarial attack which any intruder can make into the algorithm, and because of that.
So in this case, I would say we take input from multiple sources. If one source is wrong, then we trust the other source. For example, I spoke about this lane change, the lane change event which is happening from the SMPC or from the LiDAR. It can tell you whether there is a lane change or not. So most probably what happens is any one sensor can go wrong, or both the sensor can go wrong. But we have the map data. So here, map data acts as a ground truth for us, and we try to do a comparison with the map data, and map data helps us to overcome the erroneous situation of the sensor. So we trust fully the map data, and then we try to do a comparison of the sensor. So sometimes what happens is one sensor is true, or both the sensors are wrong. If one sensor is true, then we'll do a comparison with that stuff. We'll just try to do a comparison of the map with the SMPC, if SMPC is right, or map with the LiDAR, if LiDAR is right, or if both are wrong, then we trust the map, means we trust the map, and then subsequently the actions is being taken up.
Okay, thank you, Deepak. Thank you.
Sir, I had another question.
Yes.
Question in the last, because we already have an open house at 4:20. So first let all the speaker complete their speech, and then we can take all the questions. You can write down all the questions meanwhile.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I'll be posting the links which I was not able to share with you guys. If the link is available, if that link is available, then you guys can go and have a look. Otherwise, you can also search for the press release event of the Mercedes S-Class. And at that time, all the press reporters were invited, and they were showcased the S-Class with the level 3. So you guys can go and have a look. I'll share the link anyways. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you, Ahlad, and thank you, Sneha.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Now I would like to invite Mr. Sukiran Maiti, who is the co-founder and CEO at Litmus Analytics. Sukiran is an accomplished leader in the analytics space with over 15 years of experience across multiple business functions. After commencing his career as a marketing analytics professional, it is the very passion of taking analytics to a non-traditional and undeserved areas that led him to take up new roles in creating analytics practices across risk and compliances, operations and HR. So Kiran holds a bachelor degree and master degree in statistics from Indian Statistical Institute with a major in mathematical statistics and probability. Mr. Sukiran Maiti.
Thank you, Sneha. Although I'm not going to talk about mathematical statistics and probability, I have one slide that I wish to present. Just give me a moment while I try to bring it up, okay? Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, it is.
All right, fantastic. In fact, when I talked to your director, I was told that I should be talking about what I look for. So I thought I'll use my interview experience, whatever I have had over time, and talk about what exactly do we look for in a particular candidate. But before I start, getting into all the details, let me say on a more lighter note. We are used to this cliche that says that whatever we learn when it comes to actual work, we hardly use it. But let me tell you, my 22 years in the industry, what I've seen is what I learned and what we have to learn in the data science area today is a lot more. And whatever we learned during our coursework in the college, in the university, all of them are quite relevant, all of them are quite useful. Okay, so that's why I feel that this is a fantastic area to be in, and please pay attention to all the things that are being taught. I have looked at your course structure and I was quite fascinated to see how balanced it was in terms of what a typical employer would be looking for. So when it comes to data science, and I'll give you a context as to what kind of work we do, what kind of clients we have, and why I'm coming from a particular angle. Most of my client, given my experience, I have done banking analytics, being part of a bank and lending organization for close to 15 years, which is what Sneha mentioned. And I worked in various departments, marketing, risk, operations, and within operations, there are multiple functions like fraud, collections, customer care, and all those things. So we did analytics for pretty much all possible functions you can think of in the bank. And when we started this company, Litmus, that's when we thought that why don't you, in fact, start giving consulting in those areas? And while we started, we realized that what you are looking for and what people are coming up with in terms of the education, in terms of the expectation, there's a huge gap. And that gap is arising because of multitude of reasons. Partly because of the coverage of certain things in the media, in the newspaper, or possibly in LinkedIn, everywhere. It almost seems like everything boils down to doing cutting edge stuff. Quite honestly, if you ask me, I would say that what we look for is individual who can make the data talk. Okay. Now, given that we work in bank, most of our modeling or analytics that we do, they relate to a customer, and the customer could be retail customer or it could be corporate customer, SME, anything like that. So we are not heavy on image or, for that matter, voice kind of things. That's where maybe the application of deep learning and all those things that you hear about typically, it's not something that we do. Our work is pretty much trying to predict or trying to give insights from the data about customers, about portfolio, about marketing campaigns, about risk management, and so on. The two things that we are quite famous for is credit risk management, and the other one is financial crime risk management. So while I'll talk about what I want to say, I'll bring in examples from these two. So first and foremost, whenever it comes to doing any kind of business problem, finding solution to any kind of business problem, the first thing is we have to think about the problem formulation. I think before me, I did hear Pallab actually talk about it multiple times. And he was talking about the fact that ultimately how to make it work. And that's very important. Even Rahul did actually mention that ultimately it all boils down to whether you can apply something in certain situation, trying to get data or for that matter, making some insights which is usable by the business. Those are the kind of skills that you're looking for. So wherein, if we think about the three things that you're looking for, one is a quantitative part and the other one is technology part. I think the bigger part, I would argue, is the application part, which is where it becomes very important that we look at a problem and we say that, okay, I understand this problem is a class of problem which is possibly from queuing theory. Or for that matter, you look at a problem, you say, that, hey, you know what, this seems to be a binary classification problem, so I can use maybe logistic and so on. Unfortunately, I want to say that many a times what I've heard is that people almost start with technique and then go backward and talk about data and so on. And that's my experience that I thought I'll share with you so that when it comes to, and this is a message for the student, when it comes to interviewing with various companies or working in various companies, please pay attention to the lower part, this application side of it, before even you start talking about what technique is useful. Because ultimately it's very contextual. Many a times it may so happen that you do not need to do a sort of, as I said, neural nets or a boosting model. All you need to do is provide a very simple data visualization and try to convince the stakeholders just by storytelling based on the data. Let me talk about a particular example, and this may be very interesting for you to know. For example, we work with a lender. They are into students' loan, and they want to understand who are the students they should be selecting to grant a loan. Now, if you think about this problem, it's not that, oh, it's a prediction model. So if you have a historical data about which are the students who turned bad, which are the students who did not, then you can build a model. Quite honestly, that is oversimplification of the problem. But if you start formulating this in a different way, then you'll see that your subsequent modeling becomes very easy. For example, if you're talking about, let's say, student, and you want to think about, okay, what kind of student we would be able to sponsor or for that matter, give loan to. If you start thinking about it, then you'll see that the answer will actually come from within. And then subsequently, what again, previous speakers were talking about that how to collect data and so on. But first, if you spend time talking about the design, for example, in this case, all right, if a student needs to be given a loan, possibly there are 3-4 criteria that you could look at. First one, and the criteria not in the sort of transactional sense of criteria, you are almost saying the pillar. First, let's look at what is the worth of the student in terms of academic records and so on. And maybe if the student is actually trying to go out, look at GRE score, TOEFL score, or any of those things. So you almost think about, let's look at student characteristics first. Then comes, many a times, maybe the student does not have the most excellent track record, but it may so happen that the student actually has a backing in a co-borrower who could be mom, dad, or brother, sister, anyone, right? So you could also think of, hey, you know what? For this particular problem, looks like we would also be able to look at some of the co-borrower related trait. And then comes another point. You say, hey, you know what? If you're giving a loan to a student, chances are it's not that the student's parents are going to pay back. It's the student who is going to pay back. So is there a way for us to know, given where the student is actually going to study, maybe the country or for that matter, the college, what kind of job prospect is there? And how do we create variables which actually can predict that if somebody has taken a particular course from this particular college, then chances of this person getting placed with this kind of salary range is this much. So you can imagine how this problem is being formulated. You almost say that, okay, I have a student characteristic. Then you talk about, you have some co-borrower. And the third one, you're talking about what kind of university or the country that person is going into. And last but not the least, many a times you want to cover your risk. So you would look at maybe all these three pillars, they're not looking that great. So you'd say that, could you have some collateral or something like that so that, you know, you can still, you know, give you a loan. So, you know, I thought if you think about this one, the model training comes much later. The very fact that we are structuring the problem this way, it becomes very easy for us to now know, okay, let's see where these information are. Many of them could be within the organization, in the data warehouse, in various places. Many of them need to come from outside. For example, let's say university ranking or college ranking, just to get an understanding of what can happen over there. I'll talk about another example, and this is something that will also make you understand how important it is to also be aware of the technology side of the story. Incidentally, I have my natural bias. Given my education in statistics, I always thought that data science is all about knowing stats, maths, ECO, and other things. By the way, make no mistake, you have to be very good in those things. And I did see that in your course coverage, you have things like linear algebra, statistics, and of course, you have also programming things coming in over there. That's very important. But when you're talking about preparing for interviews and so on, please keep in mind that there are interviewers who are going to ask you not about which particular package of Python to use to train a model. There will be questions about, okay, if you're running a regression, what kind of assumptions you have, why it violates, why it is violated in a particular situation, why would you take another technique? Those kind of things are going to come up. And chances are interviewers actually expect you to know the basics more than knowing which packages you are using. So if you excel in that one, chances are you are going to be selected, and selected with, I would say, lot of you know, trust that given an unknown problem, you'll be able to solve that particular problem. So I'll talk about this insurance example. So here is one where, again, coming to this sort of bottom part, why it becomes very important that other than problem formulation, there are things like data management, business relevance, explainability, and storytelling that we have to do. So in this insurance one, we are talking about detecting fraud through information misrepresentation, okay? So if you can imagine, you're going to buy insurance, and let's say there's a fraudster who is actually buying insurance, or for that matter, there's a syndicate of fraudster who are actually buying insurance. Chances are they will do two things. One is maybe the application is totally decorated. The other one is maybe the application is not decorated, but there are things which are possibly hidden in such a way that it's very difficult to detect who the actual beneficiary is and what the status of that health status, and we're talking about health insurance, of that particular person is. Now, here the challenge was, you know, you can say, oh, this is also a classification problem. If you have previous data, then you can figure out what is fraud and what is not. But quite honestly, I'll tell you how the constraints come in the business. And that's where you start almost thinking about, well, you know what? Techniques, programming, all those things are good, but there are other things that we have to do. This model cannot be housed in an environment which is sort of open, okay? It has to be in an environment which is highly secured. And given the multitude of systems this particular big organization has, you also cannot have a situation where all the data will be exposed to you. So pretty much we're talking about exposing this model just as an API and nothing else. Now, all the while, we are thinking that, okay, it's very simple. We'll build the model and embed it, give it to someone so that the person can do the coding, and eventually the results will be out for investigation. But that did not happen. This is where we had to sort of have those extra layer of people coming in who can convert a particular model into API and then subsequently manage that infrastructure, whether it's cloud or it's a private cloud or so. So that's where this data management and all these other skills, which again has been told by my previous presenter, that how how to make things work, how to make things work, and that is very important. So my last point, there is one very important element here, and I just want to talk about that one. In case you are thinking that there is a sort of data science that you have to be very good at, I would almost argue that yes, we do have data scientists, but we also lack information artists. And I would almost say that there are people who can make brilliant, brilliant messaging just based on powerful graphics. So pay some attention to various kind of data visualization technique, and not the run-of-the-mill like the bar chart, pie chart, and all those things. But depending on the context, I would say that if you hone your skill on the data visualization space, there are quite a few problems that can be solved quite effectively. And particularly the business that you work in, where it's not tech heavy for that matter, unlike what previously has been told, like the Mercedes example and then the supply chain example. Here we are talking about business which are very people intensive, process intensive, and so on. And many times the stakeholders that you work with, they are usually their background may not be in data science, so they will usually come from a very varied degree of background and very little understanding of statistics or mathematics, for that matter even the data science techniques that you talk about. So storytelling and data visualization is your friend, and keep in mind that, given my understanding of the industry, if you start constructing like a pyramid of the skill requirement, there are substantial number of people who are required to be there, who can just interpret basic data and then present it to stakeholder with a very, very powerful messaging. So with that, I will sort of end my talk here. If there are questions, I'll be happy to take the question right now.
The question session will be after all the speakers will speak, and then the students will take part.
Thank
in
you,
that.
Sugir, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sugir Prof.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Sukiran Maiti. Now we will move onwards, and I will like to invite Mr. Nagendra Shastri, who is working at ProLink. His total work of experience is 24 years in multiple domains. In space technology at ISRO, software engineering and process consulting and business analytics, have built and led team to do strategy, consulting and analytics, worked extensively in the banking and financial services vertical to provide marketing and risk analytics and predictive models to the banks, credit unions and fintechs in the US. He is also co-founded IQR Consulting in 2009, an analytics company in Ahmedabad. And after EXL acquired it in 2016, he became part of EXL leadership. Recently, he has left EXL and joined a boutique consulting company, ProLink, to grow its financial services analytics vertical. Mr. Nagendra Shastri.
All right. Thank you so much for giving the opportunity. And I'll just make a few observations, or rather comments first. And after that, I think I'll start presenting. I won't take too much of time. I'll just take about maybe 5-10 minutes for presenting my deck. Essentially, I think most of the speakers have covered these aspects. I think the primary beautiful spot where I think data scientists or data analytics people are there currently is as part of the amalgamation between, let's say, the IT and the on the techniques which are related to statistics and the machine learning and other things and all that. In addition to that, we also have business component. I think that is one thing that most of the speakers did talk about it. Rahul talked about it, and Sukiran Maiti talked about it, and Pallab talked about it, and prior to that, I think the one Dr. Panda talked about it, right? Whatever be the domain, I think one of the things that needs to be understood by these students is how do I be curious for a very long time? How do I ask questions which are more relevant in order to make sure that the domain is understood properly? Be it insurance, be it banking, be it automobiles, or be it supply chain or anything like that. I think that is one aspect which I keep stressing whenever I recruit people, that you have to be curious and you have to be asking questions and you have to come to the table with some kind of, you know, a point of view, because that's what actually most of the clients expect. Because imagine a 2-year experienced person in my team talking to someone who has about 20 years of experience working in a bank about bank. I mean, it sounds funny. However, there is a powerful weapon that you have in your hands, that is data. And using that data, you are able to provide those insights which that 20-year experienced person is unable to look at, or rather, no, he has not been, he has been looking for that, right? That kind of nugget. So that's where I think the power comes. That is how I keep telling people that, no, you have to really look for that. And that storytelling part and the way in which, see, it's not really a very, very unique skill. Many people have learned it. I think the beauty lies in the fact that if you are able to explain things to someone who has deep technical knowledge about your techniques and the models that you have created, that's also required. And on the other hand, I'm not a data scientist, by the way. I'm a consumer of data science profession. And at the same time, I'm also a provider of data analytics services to the clients. So that's a good spot that I am in, I think. So what happens here is that, you know, we also need to be able to explain things to someone like a CEO or a CMO, that is a chief marketing officer, or a chief lending officer, or it could be a CRO, the chief risk officer, right? So all these people, they are interested in the techniques and they might really be experts in their own fields, and they might even want to go into the details of statistics and mathematics and all that. However, you also should be able to explain in simple terms as to what the objective of the problem was, what was the whole thing all about, and then what did you do, basically the approach that you have taken, what was the data, not necessarily going into too much of data details, but still be able to actually explain a little bit about the data, and then conclude, these are the recommendations and that kind of stuff, right? So that is how we usually structure the presentations. If you want to go into the details, you'll always have the appendix for about 50 slides or whatever, but the main deck, main presentation, we keep it to about whatever, 10 slides, 12 slides. That is the, that's how I think, you know, the entire exercise has to be distilled and presented. So that's one thing. And then there are other aspects which I just want to cover from the technology point of view. I think, you know, Rahul did talk about it in the beginning itself, and others also, of course, mentioned about various techniques and tools and all that. Essentially, going back to what Mr. Maiti talked about, right? Many people may not necessarily need the deep learning techniques in order to solve one problem, right? So it could be solved perhaps using Power BI or Tableau or Excel, SQL, or you can have SAS or other related tools and all that. You don't need to necessarily think of always hitting, or rather, you know, using a big hammer in order to kill a small ant. It'll not even get killed, by the way, right? So that is how it has to be looked at. I think, you know, the techniques are important. They are really important, especially when you talk about some of the problems that Mercedes-Benz is trying to solve, for example, right? So yes, it all depends on the problem is what I'm trying to explain, I believe, right? So that's where I think the approach has to play a very important role. It also depends on, of course, what is the environment in which, you know, you're actually working. When I say environment, what are the constraints? For example, there is a client who could be a Microsoft shop. It means that you have to work within that particular environment where the tools are really constrained. I mean, when I say constrained, they have huge number of features, no doubt about that. But still, even if you want to, for example, use, let us say, AWS, no, they won't let you. I mean, it's that kind of thing, right? That is one. The other things are, for example, there are many, should I turn on the camera or is this okay? It's okay. So there are many cases, right? Now, there are many banks and financial services companies, insurance companies, which are legacy. They have legacy systems. And they may not, for various reasons, especially because of the info security and other reasons and all that, they may not even allow you to install the open source languages platforms and all that. So what do you do then, right? Now you have to have that particular constraint understood, and that's how you have to build your algorithms and build your data analysis results and all that. So those are the things that need to be thought through. It doesn't mean that you shouldn't learn them. That's not what I'm suggesting. You should obviously learn and excel in all these things. However, you also have to be not married to a specific tool or a technique. You should be flexible enough. You need to really come from the problem point of view, and then exactly like Mr. Methi talked about, right? You need to be able to understand what the techniques that are available to you in front of you, and what is the problem, and what technique is suitable for which kind of problem, rather than really force fitting the technique to the problem, right? You know, which you should never do. So that's one thing, right? And then I'll just open the presentation that I have. You know, it's a very sorry, it's a kind of funny. One second. Are you able to see the screen? I think yes, I can see it on my mobile as well.
Yes, we can see.
Yeah, so this is something that I had already presented, but I thought, no, let me pick it up and then open it for presentation. So I just wanted to walk some of these students through the different scenarios that you actually encounter within your just day-to-day life. And then tell me where the analytics is in this, right? And so that's what we talked about, multiple problems. I mean, we talked about various speakers. I mean, they talked about the problems as challenging as computer vision, it could be a supply chain challenge and all that. No, but how do you observe, and how do you actually make sure that you are able to connect the dots in your day-to-day life is what I was thinking. So most of the students I know, they don't wake up at 6:30 a.m. but no, for a minute, stay with me. And then let's say it is 6:30 and you wake up and you finish your chores and are relaxing with a cup of coffee. You see an email from one of the e-commerce platforms giving you an offer on the item that you had placed in the basket but did not buy, right? So you also see other product recommendations. You know, it's a familiar situation, right? And so what goes on behind that? So shopping cart abandonment is a major issue for e-commerce players. So you need to be able to analyze as an analyst, you know, what are the different drop-off points? How does the user experience compare to other sites? You know, what is the user feedback on the UX? And are you doing some kind of A/B testing? Because that's what is going to be the major area of focus, especially if you're in the marketing area and all that, right? So what kind of features are you testing? What worked, what did not work? So again, like going back to what earlier speakers talked about on the campaign analytics side. So are you able to really capture those ideas and capture those ways? Now, when you are able to do the test design, are you able to do it on enough sample size? Like how are you able to show, let's say feature A to X number of people and feature B to X, Y number of people, and then get that and make sure that you're able to interpret the results in the in the statistically significant way, right? So that is where your expertise is going to come into play, right? Because as a marketing person, I will say that, no, okay, so tweak this image here and tweak that image here, or no, change the text here and change the text there. But is that really going to give me the result, what I'm really looking for? So I'm sure, you know, all of you have learned about, you know, hypothesis testing and all that. Right, but have you really understood the significance of those terms and tests in practice? So that's where these things come into play, right? So there are multiple software applications that are available again here. There's something called as Optimizely, Monitor It, and all that. You may be asked to actually go into these softwares and then, you know, look at them and then start actually experimenting, or rather, you know, doing your coding in those softwares and all that. So one thing, again, I keep telling my recruits is that you should be absolutely ready to actually get into the dirty job of handling data or handling some of these software tools which may be new altogether, right? So if you if you don't like data or getting dirty with the data, I'm afraid this is not the job for you at all. I think we should rethink about your career. So shopping cart recovery, that will happen again. Like product recommendations, there are multiple actually techniques here: collaborative filtering, content-based filtering, hybrid recommender systems. All these are, I'm not going to go into the details because I can't even go into the details and all that. However, the point that I'm trying to make here is that so many things go in the behind, right? So you see just an email and you think that, I either ignore that or you at least start paying attention or whatever it is, right? But so much of work is happening behind the scenes. And that is where your role is going to come into play when you actually get into the industry, right? Okay, now let's move on. Like it's about 8:30 and you're ready for the break. After your breakfast, you get a text message that you are overdue on your car payment. Now, what do you do? Right now, you need to think of actually visiting the bank for a loan also, because those are the two things that you had in mind. Okay, now, credit risk is something that again, Smriti talked about that giving money on loan is easy, right? No, collecting is not. And he also talked about how the work on collections and all that is done in the banks and all, right? There is a major, one of the major risks that a financial institution faces is obviously the credit risk. And logistic regression models, machine learning techniques, and XGBoost and all that, they're all used to build predictive models. And one of the things that I again keep telling some of the people that I recruit is that it is better to go through the typical logistic regression model building process in order to really understand what goes on, right? Because you need to go through the univariate analysis, bivariate, multivariate analysis. You need to create graphs. You need to really understand what the information value is all about. And you need to really understand what is the multicollinearity that you are actually observing in the variables. All that has to be done in order to really build the final model. I think downloading or using some of the drag and drop tools for building a model is great. It's going to be less of it's going to reduce the time. However, it's not going to teach you much. So make sure that you are actually doing this properly in terms of feature engineering. How do you create the derived variables and what are the different variables that you're going to look at? By the way, the credit bureau, like CIBIL, I don't know how many of you students have credit cards or not, but your life is known much more in detail to the credit bureaus than to your own family members. The way they collect the data is massive, and the way they collect the data and impute the variables and derive the variables and all that is really amazing. There are thousands of variables that are available to you on one individual if you want to build a model, right? And so how do you bring those thousands of variables into meaningful set of variables so that they really fit into the logistic regression model? Because a logistic regression model typically will not have more than 15, 16, at the most 12, 13 or around variables, right? So how do you distill that is something that you should learn in the beginning. After that, you can go to the XGBoost and then say that, I'm going to dump all the variables and then build a tree of trees and then see how the result is going to be there. And I think a couple of speakers, I'm forgetting, but they also spoke about explainability of the model, which is very important, especially on the risk side. On the marketing side, there may not be so much of scrutiny. However, on the risk side, the regulatory agencies actually do want you to explain each and every variable and explain I don't know how much you are aware of, but in the US, you're not supposed to use any demographic variables in the model. And as far as behavioral variables are concerned, there also you have to make sure that some of these variables are not used, which are intentionally being used to segregate out some of the people. For example, I am black and I am a lady who is about 65 years old or more, and I'm not getting the credit card. I have applied. You need to give me an adverse action reason in order to tell me why I didn't get the card, right? Now you need to be able to tell me that this is the reason why I'm denied the credit. You can't deny me the credit just like that. So how do you create these adverse action reasons? What is the logic that you're going to actually create, use for that? And there could be like I said, there are hundreds of variables, and there could be an adverse action reason on each and every variable. How do you pick the top four or five? So what goes on inside that? What is the process, right? So there are so many things that need to be thought through. Currently I'm working on an interesting consulting assignment where we are helping one of the large personal loan companies in the US to launch a credit card. One is to have the data from the credit card portfolio to help the product owners to make sure that the customers are retained, customers are actually giving you the revenue that they are supposed to give, and customers are actually acquired properly, and so on and so forth. Here, we don't have any data at all. This is the first time that they're actually getting into the business of credit cards. How do I do that, right? What kind of models do I build now? And what are the, systems that I need to have access to, or in order to pick them and then bring them here, in order to make sure, how do you make the decision? I mean, decisioning cannot happen by people who are sitting in the branches or in the head office or whatever it is, right? The credit analyst team that actually sits in the branch or in the head office, you can't do that. It's not a scalable model. It's a very costly model. How do you automate that decision? How do you make sure that you actually have the systems ready for customer acquisition, customer management, fraud, how do you call the credit bureaus? What happens once the customer is onboarded? All that, right? There are so many angles to that. That's what I'm working on currently. Anyway, so this is one thing. And others talked about, the data collection, data access is another important thing. There are many other ways in which you can collect the data. Of course, you may have to subscribe to some of these data sources and all that. For example, there is a DNB, that is Dun & Bradstreet data, that is available. That comes for the commercial entities, right? So whereas if you talk about some of the other data sources such as LexisNexis, that's one data source that is available. You need to subscribe, like I said. There are multiple others. For example, how do I check the fraud, especially if I give an email? Or what is the guarantee that I'm actually not logging in from a device which is known for fraud? And you may not believe this, but there are people who will talk about how what is the distance between the address at which the person is living, right? The location, and the location from which the person is actually logging in, as far as the device is concerned. So if it is too far off, then there is some red flag that is going to be raised. All those things come into play here, right? Especially for the fraud. Now, as far as the banking is concerned, a large body of work has been done. There are so many things here. If you take a look at the life cycle, acquisition, engagement, retention, risk management, multiple things have been done here. It could be repricing, product upgrade, it could be pre-attrition, attrition, what do you do, what kind of strategies. And then on the risk, we already talked about so much in detail. What do you do as far as pre-approval response modeling is concerned? Invitation to apply response modeling is concerned, especially on the loan side, lending product side and all that. Another thing that I just want to highlight here is that in the US, you do have so many paper mails going out every month. And most of the fintechs, you may not believe, I don't know how many of you are again aware of an entity called as Lending Club. Lending Club is one of the pioneering fintechs which gives loan online. Okay. And how do they acquire customers, or how do they run the campaigns? Through paper. Millions of paper mails are actually sent out every month by Lending Club in order to let the Americans aware of the fact that, yes, there is a possibility of you getting a loan, and so on and so forth. So the paper mail cannot be ignored at all. And that's what is called as direct mail. And it's costly, obviously. Paper is costly, and it also has a lot of lead time, right? And how do you create the models so that the cost, marketing cost, is optimized? Because I don't want to send to someone who I know is not going to respond, or the probability of response is going to be lower for this particular individual. I'll not send the paper mail at all. I don't want to waste the cost there. Okay. If you go to the insurance part, I think there are many things that can be done there. there are multiple businesses also within insurance, like life and annuity or property and casualty, healthcare, home, so on and so forth. And you have marketing analytics, claims analytics, again, the, especially on the insurance side, I think, you know, the fraud angle was covered. Actuarial analytics, agent, broker-related analytics, call center analytics, which is very, very critical in case of, you know, insurance and all that. And there are so many new age companies that have come up, which are completely kind of online. Again, there's a company called Lemonade, which has pioneered this in the US, and there are many other companies in Germany, here also, CoverFox, for example, and so on. Right, the typical techniques that are used are profiling, collaborative filtering techniques again for product recommendations, decision trees, logistic regression for campaigns, and for fraud you can do multiple things using even image and other analytics and all that, right? So sentiment analysis and so on and so forth. So if I go to the next one, this is what I was saying. On the left-hand side, the digital insurance claims engine is something that, you know, that we built last year as part of, because, you know, a couple of my team members were stuck without their computers due to COVID in their hometowns. So I thought, how about using satellite data for actually understanding what has happened in case of a calamity, right? So there is a pre event image and there's a post event image. In fact, in order to discuss this also, I had come to DAICT, discussed with Professor Das Gupta and also with Dr. Anindu Ghosh and all. But the point here is that, you know, there are images that are available online. For example, you know, Kaggle, all of you must be obviously aware of Kaggle. And there are competitions there, and there are open source data sets there. And this particular data set was available to us, right? So we had a Maxar satellite company's image set. So this is pre-event and post-event. Of course, this is a satellite data. Obviously, you will see mainly the roof and other features, not necessarily the orthogonal features that can be made available, right? So this engine we built using some of these techniques, where the images are compared, and after that the structures, basically the buildings, right, they're identified, whether is there any destruction, is there a major destruction, minor destruction, or no destruction at all, right? No damage, minor, major, and destroyed kind of thing. So this was tested on multiple sets of images which are already available. And then we also brought in a few more images which are fresh from, let us say, Australia, by collaborating with someone there. And then we tested that. And this is how it turned out. You know, this is what we thought, you know, we will use for a few more clients. And then I think, monetize this. So that's what is happening. It's all part of EXL anyway. So now I'm not part of EXL. So other things that I already touched upon are, these are different, let's say, digital insurance companies that you can see. And all of them are using AI, IoT, or ML, or something or the other in one way or the other. Right. So that's a very good thing. That's a very nice thing. Okay. Now, I just thought I'll capture this ecosystem that we have currently in India about agriculture related, right? Now, AgTech. This has got nothing to do. I'm not talking of the techniques here, but if you see the amount of AgTechs and also the amount of data that is being captured, it's phenomenal. You have people, for example, a company in Bangalore called SatSure, which uses satellite data for actually, credit risk modeling of farmer, so that, you know, they can help the banks in understanding whether the collections are going to happen or not. And then there are other companies called as Cropin and all that, and other Fasal, which use IoT and satellite data and combine everything, and then, you know, provide advisory services to the farmers or the FPOs, farmer producer organizations and all that, right? And there are other companies which are on the input side or on the output side. And Stellabs is another lovely company which actually is revolutionizing the dairy related work, the supply chain, using again analytics and data and IoT and all that. So that's what happens. Yeah, there is another area which is in the medical imaging area, you know, called as Cure.ai, which is part of Fractal Analytics. And Cure.ai actually uses, again, you know, AI and ML techniques for medical image analysis. And it has done wonderful work in the radiological images of brain, chest, and whether classifying them into benign or malign. And there is another wonderful startup called as Niramay in Bangalore, which uses AI and advanced modeling techniques for, it's essentially a privacy-ensured and non-invasive thermal scans into benign or malign used for breast cancer detection. And there are many others. That's what is happening here. And I think somebody also talked about economic recovery. I think Rahul, especially on the Mondelez side, we thought, you know, we'll also take a look at how the data is telling a story about economic recovery. We wanted to see, are we in a position to actually tell our clients a little bit in advance when to open up the marketing, when to start actually going into the street. It could be using branches, or it could be using some of the other marketing channels and all that. So that's what we thought. So if you see, there are so many data sources again. And if you, essentially, I'll just stop here because you can visualize many such scenarios, right? No, so they could be, related to food ordering or retail stores and other things and all that, and many things. I also want to actually encourage you to take a look at some of these talks, right? No, there is one talk by Hans Rosling, which is very good as far as visualization is concerned. And second, I also want you to take a look at the TED Talk of 2017, actually, by someone who says that, you know, I built machine learning algorithms to, randomize my life. He said that, you know, he used it for actually randomizing where to go, when to live, where to live, and what kind of events to attend, and so on and so forth. And eventually he says that, you know, I don't know whether it became truly random or it became more of the machine learning algorithm learning the behavior and the interests and whatever, right? So the preferences and all that. And essentially saying that, okay, you know, this is becoming more and more predictable rather than really random, right? So I think all these things are very, very interesting. And there is a Spotify podcast by another company in Singapore. What is it called? I forgot. But it's again about Crayon Analytics. Crayon Analytics. The CEO says that, you know, there are other aspects to the entire algorithms, right? So, what is happening? Have they started dictating us? You know, are we the slaves to the algorithms? So he talks about that. He interviews many people and talks about that. And I'm sure, you know, you also have access to some of the other documentaries and talks about how the algorithms are becoming all the more pervasive. And as far as Mercedes-Benz is concerned, I do have one. I hope sometime I get that level 5 thing where I can take my hands off and then not drive it and sit in it. I'll stop there. I'm sure there are so many other things that you can think about. But
thank you, Dr. Nagendra. It was a nice talk. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'll stop sharing now.
Thank you, Mr. Nagendra.